Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I set you apart and appointed you as a prophet to the nations. You were listening to Jonathan Titilola Olakunle, a prophet and teacher commissioned and sent by Jesus Christ to the nations of the earth towards the rebirth of prophetic Christianity. May you be blessed, edified, equipped for good works, and enriched with great grace by the word of the Lord.
It is wonderful to be here today, and I give God all the glory and praise for the life of everyone here. I want to appreciate the Lord for His goodness and His mercies, for bringing us safely to Abeokuta town. I honor and celebrate every leader, every campus president, campus leader, campus worker. And I pray that this moment in God's presence will be a defining moment in your life in Jesus' name. Apostle Peter Jerry, permit me to call you Apostle. It is good to see you, sir. God bless you, sir. Pope Stephen Lawal, it is good to see you. God bless you, my brother. And President Abolade, I'm grateful for this privilege. I don't take it for granted. Thank you, sir. All right. Are there chaplains or lecturers in here today? Maybe tomorrow. So, by the grace of God, I want to teach the word of God for some minutes, say an hour or two. And Peter Jerry has said many things I actually wrote down because the Spirit is one. But let us see what the Lord will say to us. Are you following? Glory to God. Able ministers. You know, as I was praying there a while ago, the Holy Ghost reminded me of a vision I had many years ago, maybe when I was like 12 years old. And in that vision, I was like a young boy, like a farmer. I had a big hat, all this Hausa hat on my head, and I had this cutlass, like hoe, around my shoulder. And I was just finishing, like, agriculture. I didn't know that time I was studying agriculture. So it was many years later, I now look back, and I realize that actually the will of God for my life was to study agriculture. Because I went for CIT. Because all my friends were going to CIT. So when I encountered Jesus Christ in 2013, and I said, if we go back to agriculture, the way farmers raise plants, that is how you raise men for. In that dream, there was this huge maize cob, very big, like a giant maize cob. And myself as a farmer in that dream, the dilemma I had was, how am I going to bring this maize cob into the barn where it is going to be preserved, right? Do you know that it was when I was praying here, like 10 minutes ago, I got interpretation to that dream. I saw that dream in another dimension. Remember when Jesus said, truly the harvest is plenty, the harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. Jesus now said to his disciples, pray ye that the Lord of the harvest will send laborers into the harvest. We are here this morning by the grace of God to do a recruiting job. Because many years ago, myself, I was on campus like us, many of us here tonight. And it was as an undergraduate that the Lord also recruited him into ministry. So when my brother Peter Jerry was in ministry, and some people came out indicating that they had the call of God upon their life, it was a flashback of who I was, how I was many years ago. So I can relate with you. And if you came out to pray,
to dedicate your life to God, I salute you in Jesus' name. Nobody jumped from the sky. Ministers are made.
If you see a great man of God, like Apostle Jerry was saying, W.F. Kumuyi, Billy Akoni, they were made like into that thing that you see. So you are here again tonight for this couple of days to be made. Open and trusting Jesus that maybe one layer, one block, one revelation, one light will be added to that making process that God has begun in. And I pray that he that has begun a good work will perfect it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I want to prophesy now over Federal College of Education, Abeokuta. The Lord said that your east gates are opened.
Amen.
And just as John the Baptist, I was telling Brother Bolade when I got him, just as John the Baptist was the forerunner of the Christ, we are here these 2 days to serve as forerunners of what God will begin to do on your campus. Because now that the east gates are opened, God is going to be sending men to water the plant, the seed, Luke 8:11, the seed, which is the word of God. God is still yet going to be sending men to your campus to water the seeds that have been sown in these 2 days. Glory to God.
Amen.
Glory to Jesus.
Amen.
So get ready for visitors. Apostolic men are coming. Prophetic men are coming. Get ready to receive mantles, to receive anointings, to receive ordinations in this time and in this season, says the Lord. All right. The Bible says that it is good for a young man to carry his body. It is good for a man to carry his body when he's young. If you are here tonight in this hall to receive the word of God, I salute you, because many people are supposed to be here, but they are sleeping. I was telling the chief usher, right, that it takes extra sacrifice to be awake in the night to seek God. So I want to encourage you that this shouldn't just be a flash in the pan, okay? This should become a culture, a lifestyle of night prayers, night watching. Because if one of the things that makes a minister is that you have a culture of waking up in the night to pray, to seek God. The Bible says, wise shepherds watch their flock by night. Glory to God. I am also aware of the great responsibility on my shoulders these 2 days to address ministers, to address men of God, women of God. And when a minister is ministering to ministers, you know, that is like double work. Glory to God. All right. God will help us. Now, able ministers. That's the theme for this conference. Comprises of two major words. The first word is what? The second word is what? Thank you. So, if we are going to accurately capture the will of God for calling for this conference, then we need to set our coordinates by giving clear definitions to what the Lord has called us together to meditate on. Able ministers. Because if we don't accurately define something, we are dead on arrival. If you don't accurately define what God is doing or what God is saying, then anything you do will be in error. Because if your first step in capturing the will of God is actually asking yourself, what is this thing? That is why Mary said, how shall these things be? You need to be in a place where the will of God is clearly stated and clearly known. So what did God mean by able ministers? Are you following me? Part of being an able minister, especially a teacher of the Word of God, is to first of all define the subject to the people that you are teaching. You can't just rush and... No, you have to... Paul the Apostle said, is like a wise master builder, line upon line, precept upon precept. That is how men are built. So what is the meaning of able? Are you taking notes? You know, I'm a teacher. I have to see you writing. I wish my board was here, but... What is the meaning of the word able? Able means denote, it means there's an ability. There is competency. There is mastery. There is an ability to do something, to perform, to execute a task at hand. You can deliver on the job. That is what it means to be able. If you feel like sleeping, you can stand up and be an usher, as my brother Peter Jerry said. Or I will come and do the ushering job and tell you to stand up. If you feel like sleeping, stand up. I remember many years ago, Lawrence Oyo, Evangelist Lawrence Oyo, he taught us how to pray for long, 9 p.m. to 6 a.m. We stand up on our 2 feet. When you feel like sleeping, you will lean on something and you keep praying. Sometimes it is in the cold Amatan like this, in UI praise, Chapel of Resurrection in UI. That's how we're trained, how to pray for long. So if you feel like sleeping, stand up. I want to expect that there are ministers here. So if you as a minister, you are sleeping, what do you expect the people that you are leading to be doing when you are minister? So enforce some personal discipline. If you feel like sleeping, stand up. Glory to God. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20 to 21. Let's quickly go there. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20 to 21. The Bible says that, but ye have not so learned Christ. Ephesians chapter 3 from verse 20 to 21. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all the ages, world without end. Amen. 20 says, now unto him that is able to do. I'm still helping us to define the word able. The Bible says he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all. Above what? All that we can ask or think. Turn to your neighbor and say, you are able. In Christ Jesus, you are able. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. Part of being an able minister is to open the Bible for your the people you are ministering to see, to read for themselves. You know, let's read scriptures first. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. If somebody is there, you can read out loud.
And God is able to make all grace abound
towards you. Amen. So that scripture makes us understand that God has ability. God is omnipotent. He has all power. He is the strong and mighty God. So do we have a good definition of what the word able means now? Can we move on? Okay. The second word we want to study is the word minister. I was saying something earlier that in our day and time, ministers must be more intentional about opening the Bible to read. And if you are given an opportunity to teach or preach the word of God, one of the signs that we know that you are an able minister is that you open the Bible to read. You know, there is this thing about the prophetic ministry. The assumption is that once a man calls himself a prophet,
He does not feel like prophesying. He does not feel like teaching. He's not a Sunday school teacher. But he must prophesy.
So the idea is that if he close the Bible and start prophesying, one of the tests for an able minister is that my father-in-law, Reverend Dr. Paul Olaniyan, he taught me that in 30 minutes, if you don't open your Bible in 30 minutes, I wonder what you are preaching and teaching from. It's a discipline that is lacking in the generation of ministers in our own contemporary time. And it has to be corrected. If Daddy Gio does not open Bible to show his people the word of God, why are you now complaining that people don't read scriptures again? That's why you can be arguing that the Holy Spirit is different from the Holy Ghost. Because you don't open Bible to read. So it is a discipline and a culture that must come back to the church. If you are going to church, carry your Bible. Carry your Bible.
Glory to God.
Ministers. Who is a minister? What is a ministry? We need to clearly define these things in our days and time because the lines are blurred. People don't know what is what again. If I say I'm a minister, what exactly are you talking about? Because to some people now, ministry is different things. So we need to go back to the drawing board and define these things. For a generation that is in confusion, for a confused generation. Are you still here? So I wrote a book that was last year, and the title of that book is an e-book. It's titled Christian Ministry. I'm going to give Brabolade a copy, and if you want it, he can send it to you. It's a PDF file. So the title of that book is Christian Ministry. And chapter 1 of that book is titled, What is Christian Ministry? Chapter 2 is titled, Who is a Christian Minister? Chapter 3 is titled, Three Areas of Christian Ministry. I think if you truly are serious, all of you that came outside, Rabolade, you must give them that book. It's free of charge. I'm not collecting money. What I'm asking is that you pay due diligence to read it. So I'm going to use the first three chapters of this book to teach us this morning. What is Christian ministry? What is Christian ministry? Is preaching the Bible behind a pulpit like I'm doing now, is that the only thing that makes me a minister? Because I hold microphone, I open Bible, I'm teaching you, so I'm a minister. If that is your only definition of ministry, then Abraham was not a minister. Then even Jesus Christ was not a minister. Because Jesus did not have a microphone, neither did he have a pulpit. If not both, the Baba will stay inside the church. He will preach. Sometimes it is the market store. Anyway, Jesus never had a pulpit that he stood behind to address the people. Am I right or wrong? So if your definition of ministry is one day I hold microphone and stand behind a pulpit, you might not be wrong, but you might still be wrong at the same time. There's a man in the Bible called Baruch, who was the scribe of Jeremiah the prophet. You all of us know Jeremiah the prophet, Abby. But the book of Jeremiah, most of it was written by that man called Baruch. So you will quickly think Jeremiah is the minister, but you will not quickly think Baruch is a minister. Because he's not popular like you, like Jeremiah. Some of you here, you have social media ministries, right? Don't let anybody that has big church intimidate you that all these small people on social media. All these young ministers on social media that is making noise. Don't let anybody intimidate you with that nonsense. So because you have a big church now, and me, I have Telegram page, WhatsApp ministry. Because you have big church now, you are the one that is doing ministry. Mean that I have small WhatsApp ministry. I'm wasting my time. No. Some people like to give. They can give Indomie. I wanted to say Agbado. They can give Indomie, give yam, give oil. So if I don't have money to give Indomie, to give yam, I'm not the minister, I'm not kind. Is God helping us? We are defining what ministry is. So we need to study this thing called ministry so that we'll be accurate in our activities. Ministry is from the Greek word dia, diao. Hey, Greek words. Hey, Jesus. Diakonio, meaning to serve. Or duolio, meaning to serve as a slave. This one, slave, this one, you have to understand this mindset, because this is who a minister is. A minister is a servant. The mindset that you must have as a minister, Jesus told us that he has not come to be served, right? But to serve. That is the first mindset you have to have in defining what Christian ministry is. Everybody say service. Say servant. I wish I could read all of the things I have here, but because of time, I might not be able to read. To read everything. A minister is not a celebrity or a showman. A minister of Jesus is not called to impress people. As a minister of Jesus Christ, you have just one audience, and your audience is God. So I'm not here to impress you with words, to make you like me. Eh? Because when you go back to sleep, I will go and report myself before my sender, Jesus Christ. I say, this is what I did. Evaluate myself. Did I pass or did I fail? It is shocking that you can be clapping for me now. Ah, great man of God. But when I go back to report myself to Jesus, Jesus said, all the things you said is rubbish. If we understand that ministry is a call to serve, ministry is that you have been called to help people, to serve people, to be selfless. Ministry is more of sacrifice than success. For that word success, you have to repeat it. Because ministry is more of sacrifice than success. If that is what we have been taught about ministry, the half of us say we don't want to do ministry. We don't want to go and start church. Do you know why many young men like us are all of nobody wants to start bank? Nobody wants to start school. Nobody wants to start. What else? Don't leave me. What else? Why is it that every young man now wants to go and start church? It is because the way that ministry has been portrayed is like this. It is something like, a money making machine. If you want cheap publicity, I'm here to break your heart. I'm here with a sword to circumcise your heart, to make you not want to do ministry again. That's my goal here. So that the people that are really doing business with Jesus will know that this. See, it wasn't given to Joshua. There were about 20,000 or 5,000 soldiers, and God said they are too much. Take them down to the leader. At the end of the week, 300 men were those 300 men were the ones that have accurately understood what ministry is. It's warfare. It's a selfless life. If ministry were to be defined accurately in many of our churches and campuses, many people that have started something and call it ministry in the name of Jesus, we put it. We stop it. Ministry is a call to servanthood and Christ-likeness. Write it down. Ministry is a call to servanthood and Christ-likeness. The effectiveness of your ministry depends on how much of Christ has been worked in you, and you can work it out to the people of God. It is not in the Bible, but that man said, he that is too big to serve is too small to lead. It is true. Ministry, first of all, is a call to be conformed to the image and likeness of Christ Jesus. It is a call to consecration. It is a call to become more like Jesus. If it is Jesus that is sending you, you must look like your sender. Whether you are an instrumentalist or a sanctuary keeper or a chief usher or what else? What else? Prayer band coordinator. All of us must look like Jesus. The guy on the piano, on the keyboard must look like Jesus. Must play like Jesus. The sanctuary keeper must be Christ-like in sanctuary keeping. You don't leave the responsibility of Christ to your president alone and say, my president can look like Jesus. Me, I'm just a sanctuary keeper. No. Lord, prepare me a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary. For you, Lord, prepare me a sanctuary, Lord, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a sanctuary for. Ministry demands purity and consecration by the anointing. Being separate unto God. You are different. You are set for a purpose. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 8. Let your garments always be white, and do not let oil be lacking from your head. Ministry is a call to separated life. You are different from the pack. You are different from the crowd. Ministry is a call to be different. The Bible says, come out from among them and be separated unto God. Touch not the unclean thing and I will receive you. Ministry is, you still want to look like your friend, look like the world, look like many things. No, no, no. You have to be different. You have to dance to a different drum beat. You can't talk like them. You can't dress like them. You can't go where they go. You can't. Ministry with the place a demand upon your life, your sleeping habits, your eating habits, the kind of bread you take, the kind of husband you marry, the kind of wife you marry, how you spend your money, how you spend your time. We're not joking here. I don't have gray hairs on my head, but I think I learned from good disciples. It is as if that the quality, the standard has been reduced. So every young man, young woman, young pastor that can speak in tongues and study CIA in school, what of that? No. Heightened the standard again in our generation. For some time it was as if the standard was low. But there are some men and women that God has called to set the standard again. The standard of God is high. Don't let anybody deceive you. It's high. It's a high calling in Christ Jesus. It is not cheap. It is not cheap. Reject a cheap Christianity. Reject a cheap gospel. A Reject any kind of ministry that does not provoke you to sacrifice. To pray when you don't feel like praying. To fast when you don't feel like fasting. To give when you don't feel like giving. Reject it. It's faith.
Christian ministry. There are three major kinds of ministries, and they have different branches. Number one, the ministry of reconciliation for every child of God. The ministry of reconciliation, bringing people back to Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, from verse 17 to 21. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And all things are God who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he had made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Every child of God has been called to do the works of an evangelist. Whether you are apostle or sanctuary keeper, all saintly hands must be on them to snatch them from away from the fire, to save their souls from eternal damnation. That is the first ministry that every child of God has been called to undertake. If I may ask you, this is February. How many you claim that you are prayer God? How many souls have you won for God's people? Do you know the primary assignment of the prophet? The primary assignment of the prophet is to save souls. It's not to talk for number. It's to preach the gospel, to save people from hellfire. That's the primary assignment of the prophet. Every other thing is secondary. Prophesying what will happen next tomorrow and Nigeria and South Africa is secondary. What is the point? Saying that Nigeria will be the African population and yet don't fight the best of fire. What is the point? What is the point? Prophesying and it's coming. The prophets are coming to pass. People are saying, big prophet. But if that don't happen, none of the church members will go to heaven.
We have to define what ministry is. We have to know our priorities again. It is because we have forgotten what ministry is. A man of God can bring communion to the altar of God. We have forgotten our marching orders. Go ye into the world and make disciples of all nations. Last time I checked, God said make disciples, not happy people. You know, discipleship is not a love for happy people. You know, discipleship is not for. Maybe my brother will explain what discipleship is to God, but that is not what it is. Many times we cry when we pray. Many times your stomach will be rumbling in mind because we are fast. It is not a comfortable life. Jesus said, if any man will follow me, let him deny himself. Pick up your cross and follow. You know what the kind of Christianity we have restored now? If any man will follow me, let him come. There's no cross to pick. There's no self-denial. That's why we are weak and beggarly. And that's why in these 2 days, God must do a thorough job in our lives to raise accurate ministers from amongst us again. Don't quickly blame the church members. Don't quickly blame the students on campus. Blame the leaders. Blame the people that are saddled with the responsibility of raising men. At the end of the day, you will look like who or what you are following. You will look like who or what you are following. That's why Jesus said, follow me, and I'll make fishers of men. Paul the Apostle said, follow me as I follow Christ.
When Tobatin, and I speak in Yoruba, Tobatin, they said in church, it's just a reflection of who they are following.
Men, people want to be men of God, but they are forgetting that to become a man, you have to be a child first. You have to be a child of God first. Oh, man of God, we celebrate you. I'm still a child of God. I'm still learning. Don't kill me before I arrive.
We have forgotten the basic things that are the foundations of our Christian existence. And the Bible said, Jeremiah speaking, these people, they have left me, and they have made for themselves broken systems. They have left me the true fountains of living water, and they have made for themselves systems, broken systems that cannot hold anything. Clouds without rain. May God appear to you again in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The second kind of ministry is more specific. It is the ministry of helps. Genesis chapter 2 verse 18. The Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper available for him. So the first person that manifested this ministry of helps in the Bible is Eve. But when you come to the New Testament, in the book of Acts chapter 6 verse 2 to 7, then the 12 summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, it is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. So the apostles stood, but they needed support, they needed help. So that is why in a joint fellowship like this, we have the ushers, we have the sanctuary keepers. Those are the people discharging what we call the ministry of helps. And it is a legitimate, ordained ministry in the body of Christ. Do you know that the security man is also doing ministry? David made us understand that except the Lord builds the house, those that build, they build in vain, they labor in vain. And except the Lord watches over the city, the gatemen, the city of the legal, the security guard, they watch in vain. You will see a security man and you say this one is not the man of God. Let him see for 1 week and not watch over the city. Anything you do to advance God's kingdom on earth is ministry. Anything you do in a biblical way that is that Jesus patterned, that the apostles patterned, that the apostolic fathers patterned, that the Holy Ghost has given you a conviction premised around the word of God is ministry. Because there are many things that we claim to do now that is ministry, that is not ministry. Comedy can never be Christian ministry because Jesus did not use comedy to advance God's kingdom. Paul the apostle and all the apostles never cracked joke to advance God's kingdom. Are you following me?
Yes, sir.
Polycarp said, Augustine, none of the apostolic fathers used comedy to advance God's kingdom. When God laughs in heaven, the goal is not to exalt him because he's soon about to have them in there. He's soon about to drop them in there. I see an handwriting on the wall. And God is rewriting definitions in the hearts of men again. You will leave this place after tomorrow, today, tomorrow, and you will receive fresh marching orders from Jesus.
Amen.
Then we have the fivefold ministry. The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers. So the first kind of ministry is for the believer, the ministry of what? The consolation. The second one is what? The third one is what? The fivefold ministry. So not everybody will be a fivefold minister. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? No. Not everybody will be an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. But all of us should do the works of an evangelist. All of us should be able to teach scriptures, especially the essential doctrines that are the pillar of our Christian faith. We should be able to pick somebody randomly from among us and say, what is sanctification? And should we try it here? Yeah? We should do an experiment. And you just pick somebody randomly.
consecration? What is holiness? What is sanctification? What is doctrine? What are the essential doctrines of Christianity? Many of us will man, God has learned you to that you start a church. What do you want to do here? You want to start a ministry. You don't know holiness, consecration, sanctification, the seven pillars of Christianity. What do you want to do and do here? Or let me say, what are you be putting here?
You prepare with the Holy Ghost. Say, study to show yourself approved unto God. Study to show yourself approved unto God. You are not studying to be approved by your fellowship president. You are not studying so that they will give you Bible God. No, your approval first of all is from God. Study to show yourself approved unto God. A workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Glory to Jesus. There are many things to say, but because of time, just get that ebook from your president and share it as much as people that ask for it. That's my own little contribution to what God is doing on campus. I hope by now we are beginning to understand these things a little bit. Can we go deeper now? Stephen, can we go deeper? Glory to God. People want to prophesy for number, but they don't know what is love. They don't know what is the fruit of the Spirit. What is the gift of the Spirit? They want to be doing big beatings. They want to shake nations. But they can't teach salvation to a 3-year-old. And they claim they are ministers. I'm here to break your heart very well. To break it very well, so that maybe one or two or three people from here, they will get it right. Able ministers. Now, in the Bible, the place where we can get that phrase in one place is in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6. If somebody is there, you can read for us loud, please. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6.
Who also has made us
able ministers
of the New Testament,
not of the letter,
but of the Spirit.
For the letter kills,
but the Spirit gives life.
Thank you, ma'am.
We need to see some things from that scripture.
Number one, God has made us able ministers.
So you need to first of all be conscious that God is at work in your life already. You're on that pathway of your making.
Do you even believe that God can keep you from falling into sexual immorality as a minister?
Many young ministers are afraid of ministry. Do you know why? When they see fathers in the faith make mistakes, they are afraid that if this great man of God can make this mistake, who am I? But you have to also think this way. There are still fathers in the faith that, like my brother was saying, who are you? At that age, he still blessed with God's glory. No scandal. No scandal. Then as God gave guy as a successful minister with respect to scriptures.
All this marriage, all this divorce,
It can keep you from falling.
I choose to believe that one. I can do ministry in purity. It is possible. It is possible to be a man of God and you are not committing fornication. You are not committing adultery. It is possible to be a pure man of God. It is possible. Don't let the negativity cloud your spirituality. If you are looking at men of God that has fallen, and you go on YouTube, and all what you are seeing is, this man of God committed this scandal. You are treading a dangerous path. Why don't you follow those who through faith and patience obtain the promise? Why don't you look at the cloud of witness of men like Joseph that even fall onto the laps of Potiphar's wife? Why don't you consider Daniel in Babylon? That no matter how corrupt the nation can be, no matter how corrupt Nigeria can be, there are still righteous men in this nation. And you should be part of them. There is a fear over young ministers, over the next generation crop of ministers, that everybody is doing it. Everybody is, every man of God is stealing money. Me, I'm not stealing money. Me, I'm not doing it. You have to come to that place in God and say, it's me, not me, not me, not me. Do you believe that there's room for growth and maturity? If you don't have this mindset, you have failed, you have ended before you even started. Do you know that? Faithful is he that began a good work in my life. And faithful is he will finish that work. Oh, my path is like the path of a righteous man. It's a shining star. If my path shines brighter and brighter until the day of his appearing, it will keep me to the end. This is how you will do ministry for 20 years and you won't have scandal. This is how you will do ministry for 40 years and you won't have scandal. God is able to keep you from falling. God is able to keep you from falling. If God says he has made me an able minister, then I have to walk in that reality. Lower it a little bit. But strings multiply. Thank you. He has made us able ministers. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 from verse 6. Who also hath made us able ministers. But you see, your making as an able minister has boundary, has context. There is a place that if you are in that place, you will not be an able minister. But if you are outside of that place, you are a fashionable minister. No. When people are sick, they won't go to a quack doctor. Abi, when there's a legal matter, you go to a fake lawyer. But when you want to choose a church, a spiritual head, people can figure, no, that church is close to my house, let me go there. You don't go to the church closest to you. You go to the church closest to the Bible. Who have made us able ministers? So that scripture now begins to tell us the conditions, the requirements, the environment, where if you are, if you stay put there, you will be an able minister. Is God helping us this morning? So let's read. Who had made us able ministers of the New Testament? Number one. So you are an able minister to the degree at which you understand the New Testament. The things about other translation of scripture will say new what? New covenant, right? So we need to even probe that thing. What is a covenant? If we are speaking about able ministers, and the Bible said he has made us able ministers of the new covenant or of the New Testament, don't you think it is right for us to now say, okay, this new covenant, this New Testament, what is it about? Abby, are you following me? So what is a covenant? Can somebody help us?
I want somebody to help us. What is a covenant? Can just don't do crowd that I'll raise up your mind. Don't do for me. Raise up your mind. Don't try. Okay, come and try. Come. Let your generation hear the voice. Your voice is nature, so let your generation hear it. What is a covenant?
An agreement between you and God. Don't you try? Come on, try.
Let me say, where are the guys? The guys are speaking. Okay. Don't you try? You are not speaking.
What is the covenant?
Okay, the covenant is the legal binding between two parties, especially between you and God.
Glory to God. You are right.
I'll score you 50%. I'll score you. I'll give you 70%.
A covenant is a legal document. Is
an agreement between two parties. One party is superior. The other party is not superior, very inferior. Hebrews 7:7 says, without the contradiction, be blessed by the greater. I follow this. So, in a covenant, there is an agreement. Okay, let me demonstrate so that you get it. I need to tell you that you are ready to understand. My brother, come here. Come. Hurry up. Another person that is sleeping. If you are never a
ministers, right? Okay. This covenant we are speaking about, my sister said between God and man, you mentioned God, right? So usually, no, she mentioned God and people, right? So usually a covenant, that will, another word for will is what God testament. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Are we getting what I'm trying to teach? Alright. So it is called a will or a testament. So the Old Testament simply means the old agreement, the old will. And the New Testament simply means the new agreement between God and man. So testament, agreement, will, covenant. You see that? So in the Old Testament, when God began to deal with man, God is standing as the superior. Man is standing as the inferior. And you know, we define a covenant as an agreement between a superior and an inferior. And that agreement is established and written down in a will. And that will is signed by blood. So, from the days of Adam until Jesus came, what was happening between God and man was that God was entering into covenant with men, and that covenant was being agreed and sealed by blood. Are we still here? Alright. So, when Adam fell into sin, in Genesis chapter 3, Adam was trying to take fig leaves to cover his nakedness. God said, leaves cannot work, leaves will still dry. I have to give you a prophetic of the redemption and the covering of glory that Jesus will bring as salvation. So God had to kill an animal and use the skin of the animal to cover Adam and his wife. If you don't, God killed an animal, Genesis chapter 3, that will have blood will have shed. That was the first covenant of the Bible. And that was the same covenant that began to speak when Noah came to the scene. God said he will destroy the world because of the iniquity of the world. God struck covenant with Noah. In the whole of the Bible, we have five major agreements or testaments. We have five of them. We have the Noahic covenant. We have the Abrahamic covenant. We have the Mosaic covenant. We have the Davidic covenant. And we have the Messianic covenant. And all of these five covenants, they have an implication on your Christian experience. Yes. The Noahic covenant was that God will destroy the world with water. But once the rainbow is seen in the sky, God will no longer destroy the world with water. So to that end, Noah had to sacrifice a burnt offering to the Lord. And when Noah sacrificed the burnt offering, that was now when God now established that testament. For as long as there is a man to sacrifice incense, burn incense before the Lord, and God sees the rainbow in the sky, God will not destroy this world again with what? With water. Thank you very much. So, the goal of the first covenant with Noah was for the preservation of the world. The Abraham, and that was in Genesis chapter 9, verse 8 to 17, the Noahic covenant. The Abrahamic covenant is more interesting. Because here, God called a man called Abraham and said, come out of your father, your nation, your kindred, and your father's house, and I will make a great nation out of you. God said, God's part of the deed was that I will make your name great. I will bless those that bless you. I will curse those that curse you, right? And the part of Abraham was that he will come out, he will begin to journey with God. A time also came when God had to tell Abraham, take your son, your only son that you love, and go and sacrifice him on a mountain that I will show you. And I believe most of us are Bible students. We know what happened. Abraham wanted to kill Isaac. God said he shouldn't kill Isaac again. And then God struck covenant with Abraham. There was a time when God was establishing those covenants with Abraham. And God told Abraham to bring heifers and turtle doves and to cut it. And the Bible said that the angel of God went in between the sacrifice. And God now began to speak to Abraham about things that was to come. 400 years, your descendants will be in a strange land and they'll be slaves and all of that. Well, the Abrahamic covenant was to the end that a child is promised. The real person, all of those covenants one person, and that is Jesus Christ. But in times and in shadows, God had to be dealing with Noah, deal with Abraham, Moses, the Mosaic covenant was about the remission of sin. Because without the shedding of blood, there can't be remission for sin. So in the Mosaic covenant, for as long as you have an animal to kill, to sacrifice, sins will not be blotted out, but they will be covered. I can't go into all the Hebrew and the exegesis of that tonight. Glory to God. But the goal of the Mosaic covenant was for the atonement of sin. It brought about the priesthood, the Mosaic priesthood, and the five different kinds of offerings in the Old Testament. The Davidic covenant was to the end that a throne will be set that will be eternal. And it's from this throne that Jesus, the King of Kings, will sit and reign forever. The Mosaic covenant is about Jesus, but Jesus will now become the manifestation of the sacrifices that was in type and shadow in the Old Testament. But now when Jesus comes, you will no longer be needed to kill animals, because Jesus has come as the Lamb of God that will be slain for the sins of God. So all of those covenants and agreements, God was establishing with people. It is just to prepare the way for the arrival of Jesus. And that is what we call the Messianic covenant or the new covenant. The best scripture to explain the new covenant is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish. Your own part is to believe. God's part is to bring the sacrifice. You see that? Glory to God. So I'm just trying to give us a route over when we say able ministers. Not of the able ministers of the new covenant. So we should dwell more on the new covenant. Because the new covenant is the Messianic covenant. It's the covenant that Jesus came to establish on the cross. The Lord's Supper. Can we quickly go there? Because Jesus made some profound statements about this new covenant. The blood that the wine he gave them was a symbolic of the blood of Jesus that was shed for the remission of sin and the beginning of what? The new covenant. Because as I taught us earlier, there is no covenant without blood. Do you know why a lady should keep herself as a virgin? And a man should also keep himself as a virgin. I married as a virgin last year. So if I can do it, you can do it. And if you have been virgin, there is grace for you to say, I will keep myself until I get married. It is possible. Don't let Instagram deceive you. To keep yourself pure. Glory to God. Do you know why a lady and a man, they have to keep themselves pure? Because marriage is not just a contract, it's a covenant. Marriage is, there's a spiritual side to marriage, there's a soul side to marriage, and there's a physical side to marriage. I can't give a lecture on man, understanding man, on a telegram page. Glory to God. The reason why a lady must keep herself as a virgin is because so that on the wedding night, when the marriage, the agreement between the man and the woman is to be consummated, blood is going to be the proof of that covenant. Are we here together? This is why a woman has to keep herself. Maybe you are a victim of rape. I understand there are many cases, there are many instances that are not favorable, okay? But doesn't mean that you should not say, today, this thing will not define me. I choose to live pure till my wedding day. It is possible. As I'm speaking now, grace is being released for you to actually keep yourself pure. So that's why sex is powerful in marriage, because it's like you are in that contract, that agreement. When a lady, after the wedding night, when a lady shows her husband that this is the bed she's stained with blood, that one, heaven approves of it. Do you know why there are many divorces in the world? People don't know that marriage is not only with God, it's God's way. So many people are trying to run marriage with what they are Romeo and Juliet. And Titanic, they are trying to run marriage with what they have bought, not only
What the Yaren you have taught them about marriage? Not what the Bible said about marriage.
Glory to God. Glory to Jesus. If God has made us ministers of the new covenant, then we must study the man that established the new covenant. Who is that? Exactly. I'm getting deeper into our able minister now. I'm showing you what it means to be an able minister. Number one, you have to know the covenant. You have to know the person that established the covenant. So your competence, your ability as that able minister is how well you understand the covenant, especially the new covenant, the Messianic covenant that Jesus established.
The new covenant or the Messianic covenant has root in Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31 to 34. Let somebody read for us quickly.
Barakom sile paria kos kapariata. Jeremiah chapter 31, from verse 31 to 34.
Behold,
the day is come, said the Lord.
Okay.
Thank you for reading. Jeremiah the prophet begins to give us a snapshot on this new covenant. Even in the Old Testament, God will not do anything unless he reveals his servants the prophets. So the prophets have privilege to peep into the agenda of God concerning matters that will happen even after they have gone. Jeremiah here in Jeremiah chapter 31 is showing us a snapshot into what Jesus will come and do. It's like a messianic prophecy, because Jesus is the author of the new covenant. Glory to God. And the Bible says in that 1 Corinthians chapter 3 that we read, verse 6, right? That we are what? Able ministers of the new covenant. And we have seen how Jeremiah described the new covenant to us. He said in verse 33 of Jeremiah chapter 31, "But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts." Your inward parts is your heart. Holy Ghost, you will help us today.
I will put my law there
in their inward parts and write it in their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. It means that the agreement of God, the agreement God made with man in Christ Jesus, and all of his realities, like salvation, consecration, will now become our focus. Because this law will no longer be something that is outside. Remember Moses on Mount Sinai? When God encountered Moses on Mount Sinai, God gave him the Ten Commandments. Well, the commandments are actually more than 10. They're actually like maybe 400. You know, what your president is wearing now, according to Moses, so he has rebelled. Because if you wear cotton, and you wear slaves or sin,
Because those two materials are not the same. You are broken.
The law of Moses tries to make people holy from the outside in. It is based on do's and don'ts. Don't lie, don't cheat, don't steal. Thou shalt not lie, thou shalt not steal. But the law of Moses is trying to make people look like God with what they do externally. But you see, this new covenant, not of the letters but of the spirit, it will mean that it is going to be something that will happen from your inside out. Are we still here? Thank you, Jesus. So I will write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, know the Lord, for they shall all know me. Do you know how they will all know me? Because at this time the Holy Spirit will be poured out. And John made us understand in the epistle, because you are the Holy One, you have the unction of the Holy One, and you know all things. So the only way this Jeremiah's prophecy was fulfilled was when the Holy Ghost came, that becomes the unction, the teaching spirit that is not all things. Able ministers, not of the law, not of the letters, but of the spirit. For the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. So before we press further, 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 6 says we are ministers of the new covenant. Then Paul the apostle began to further do what we call, in how many of us are science students here? Comparative analysis. Paul now began to show us the difference between the ministers of the old covenant and the ministers of the new covenant. If you want to be an able minister, that means you will be a minister of the new covenant in Christ Jesus. You will not be a minister of the old covenant. And I'm going to show us here now how that being an able minister is actually being a minister of Jesus Christ and his realities. So in that 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2 Corinthians rather, right? Help me now. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6. Who has made us ministers of the New Testament? I have explained what the testament is to us. I have explained the five testaments or the five covenants or the five agreements, not of the letter, but of the spirit. Paul now begins to do comparative analysis that these able ministers, they are not servants of the letters. The letters there means the laws of Moses. That is not what they are serving. Because a minister is who? A minister is who? So that means an able minister is not of the old covenant. He's not serving the old covenant. The awareness of the old again, but is of the new. And one of the characteristics of the old covenant is that it is letters based. It is letter based. And the characteristics of the new covenant is that it is spirit based. Paul now further wrote, he said, the letters now, they bring death, they kill, but the spirit gives what? Life. When God appeared on Mount Sinai and the Israelites were afraid to go and meet God, so they said, Moses, you go and meet him. But the people that even touched the base of Sinai, the Bible said at the appearance of God 3,000 people died. Exodus chapter 19 verse 16 to 19. Because of time, you can write it down and read it in your personal study. But you see, in the book of Acts chapter 2, At the dispensation of the new covenant, when the Holy Ghost came, because the new covenant is the covenant of who? The Spirit. And the Holy Ghost came because Jesus went to the Father, right? If I did not go, the Alos Paracletos, the Holy Ghost, will not come. So it is because Jesus went to heaven. Psalm 110, the Lord shall send the rod of his strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of your enemy. The rod of his strength of God has come out of Zion, the Holy Ghost, and landed upon them in the upper room in the offensive. Are you following? Alright. So not of the letters, but of the Spirit. On the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Ghost came to establish the new covenant that Jesus established by shedding his blood on the cross of Calvary, when Peter opened his mouth to preach, 3,000 souls were saved. 3,000 people experienced life. But when God came in the Old Testament, 3,000 people died because the covenant of God brings death. But the one of the Spirit gives life. In the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant, people were led and ruled by laws, rules and regulations, do's and don'ts. But in the New Testament, things have changed. People are now led by the Spirit of God. Romans chapter 8 verse 14 says, "For as many that are led by the Spirit of God are called the sons of God." So, in the Holy Ghost, my sister, pray for 2 hours tonight, and you slept up, you not pray. That means you have broken the law of God for that day. So what now becomes our law now is the instructions per time that the Holy Ghost gives to us. Oh, you see 10% is hard. They say pray tight, 10%, they say it's hard. How can we be praying tight? In the New Testament, it's 100%. If you don't want to fulfill the Old Testament, come and fulfill the New Testament. Your salary next week, be dropping all your salary. God's servant, Apostle Edu, who they do, he said something very profound. He said in the Old Testament, God gives command. In the New Testament, God makes demand. Which one is higher? Right? Oh, you think because man is having this, you can do anything. He makes demand. People fulfill the law in the flesh. The rich young ruler, he said, since I was a little boy, I fulfilled all the commandments. Jesus now said, "Bad guy, actually." Jesus now said, "That's very good. Go and sell all your property and follow me." You know, the rich young ruler is another message for that. He was rich, he was young, and he was a leader. An average young man, that's any man. They want to be young forever. Imagine you are young and have money and you have influence in a ruler. What else are you doing? Why are you going to marry to pay? The one thing that this man has is that he has made an idol. Those his riches, his youth, and his influence have become idols. So my son said, "Leave everything and follow me." Because you will think you are good in the flesh, you will think you can fulfill the commandments of Moses until grace comes and makes a demand. When you understand grace, you will be afraid of God. The fear of the Lord will grip your soul again. You can't please God in the flesh. It takes the Holy Ghost. I did a teaching in our church last week Sunday, "Love your enemies." You need to listen to that message. Love your enemies. How many of us can say this is what you are doing for our enemies? Because they have taught you that you should all my enemies die by. But Jesus said, "Love your enemies." For you to know that we can't please God in the flesh. The best of us, our righteousness is like filthy rags before Him. So you will need to come to the place of surrender. And say, "Lord, it takes the grace of God. It takes God to please God." If you have not come to that place, you have not yet understood what it means to be an able minister. You understand that you can't be an able minister in the flesh. All your certificate, all your big, big grammar. If a Okwaram is sitting down in church, your grammar does not mean anything. The Holy Ghost has not helped you. Prostitutes still come to church. Yahoo boys still come to church. Somebody came to church today that he said, this is the last time I will come to church. What are you going to say to that kind of soul that will snatch that one from the fire? You can't be an evil minister in the flesh. You need to be of the spirit. For the letters, the laws kill it, but the spirit gives life. Religion wants to make you a good man from the outside in. So you can wear a white gown, you can put on a bishop, you can put on a cassock. But your inside is like a rotting grave. What God came to do by the Holy Ghost is actually to install life in our spirit. To install the Holy Ghost in our spirit. And from your inside, the kingdom, the civilization of God begins to break open into your environment. That's what we call transformation. That's the real transformation Paul the Apostle was speaking about in Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Brethren, I plead with you by the message of God that you present your body not as a, you present your body a living sacrifice, as a living sacrifice. You are still pretending as a, but you present your body a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable to the living sacrifice. And don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your thoughts. Your mind, something inside, something that is your inside. You don't know a person by the point of view. Why would a person still come to be alive with Jesus? No one says you want to do that. Allow the Holy Ghost to transform our inside. One day she take our door and say, what can I do with this grass? That is the true transformation. Don't try to force transformation. You expose people to the atmosphere of Jesus. And we all know their faces. Behold the glory of God as in a mirror. And the very shame from glory to glory. If you see the darkness in the world, if you see the wickedness in the world, you will know that you need to pray for a wicked generation. One of the prayer points we raise to God for this day tomorrow is that, Father, our generation shall praise your name. One generation to the other shall praise your name. This generation will praise Jesus. This generation will serve Jesus. This generation will speak about the wondrous work of Jesus. I trust Jesus that tomorrow will take time to intercede for the youth of this generation. That is one burden I brought to your campus. Able ministers of the letters, but of the spirit. For the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. The letter kills, but the spirit, it gives life. Peter,
Peter, Apostle Peter, a man that will walk on water 2 seconds after, you will be afraid and you will see. He didn't get it right. Peter was like any one of us here, off today, not tomorrow. But when the Holy Ghost came, because the Spirit gives life, he was transformed. That's how Peter preached one message and 3,000 souls were saved. Second one, 5,000. What happened? What is the difference between the Peter that could not walk on water for 10 minutes and the one that preached one message? And a whole city came to Jesus. He has touched the spirit. He has been transformed from the inside out. I pray today that some of us here under the sound of my voice, we are going to make contact with the Holy Ghost again. If the new covenant was established by Jesus Christ through the Holy Ghost, then the new covenant able minister has one goal: to minister the realities of Christ Jesus with the energy, with the strength of the Holy Ghost. That is your job as an able minister. Your job as an able minister is to reveal Jesus to your generation. It is to the degree at which you can reveal Jesus to your generation, you are an able minister. If we are to use that little step to gauge ministers in Nigeria, how many ministers that you know, we pass the score, we pass the standard? John the Beloved said, I must decrease so that he will increase. That is an able minister. Not I, but Christ. Paul the Apostle said, for me to live is Christ, and to live is Christ, and to die is gain. As an able minister, you don't have any other message than Jesus. You don't have any other message than Christ and him crucified. Paul the Apostle said, I intentionally made it that way, that when I go to preach anywhere, the only thing I will show them is Christ and being crucified. Not my big shoes, not my Lexus Jeep, not me coming out from a car and camera people are watching me. Not me taking media unit to the mountain and you know what I do. Prophet will want to die. They will say they are skin God on the mountain. They will not take their media department. You are fake, you're a liar, you are hypocrite. If that was how Joseph and your last God, you know about last name today. How many cameramen were videoing the Babalola on the mountains? Angels was his media. Human beings did not see, but God saw him. Angels witnessed of him. That is why their testimonies cannot perish. How much of the Holy Ghost do you know? How much of the Holy Ghost can you bring to, can you, how much of the reality of the Spirit can you deliver to your generation? You have come to the mountain of transfiguration today. And the Bible says, as Jesus prayed, his garment was transformed and it shone like the sun in noonday. There are some people here today that on this mountain, your garment will change. Oh my God, you are going to experience Jesus Christ in new dimensions. Some of you here, tonight marks the beginning of your ministry. You have been doing something, you call it ministry, until now. Able ministers understand that their ministry or service in God's kingdom is based on what their master has commanded them to do. That thing you are doing now that you claim it is ministry, is it Jesus that said you should do it? That thing that you claim that you are doing on social media, is it Jesus that said go ahead to do it? An able minister does not have his own agenda. He is a servant of a master. It is what the master wants that it becomes his life, becomes his marching orders. You have a master. I, Paul, a born servant of Christ. You are an able minister based on how you can represent Jesus Christ
Go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to do as I have taught you, as I have commanded you, and I will be with you even to the end of the age. If you want to be an able minister, that is your marching order. If he said, go and disciple nations, you won't be using Suya Knight. There was no Suya Knight in that curriculum, in that instruction. There was no jamboree, there was no frivolity in that instruction. We might be small here. How many were there in the upper room? How many were there in the upper room? How many are we? Are we up to 120 here? Imagine if all of us here in this hall today, we encounter Jesus afresh. How big is this campus that we cannot take it for Jesus? It will mean that we have come to the place where we truly want to be able ministers of the Spirit. That when men hear us teach, preach in our hostels, in our territories, or wherever we represent, people know these ones, they have been with Jesus. Able ministers don't follow trend. You don't follow what is trending on social media. You don't follow what is trending. You want to join them. You want to feel among. Because you want some people to welcome you into their carcass. You now want to preach like them. You want to talk like them. No. I stand for this man of God. I stand for that man of God. You are not being called to stand for any man. You are being called to stand for Jesus. Some of you are saying you are for Paul. Some of you are saying you are for Apollos. Is Christ divided? I stand for this man. I stand for this man. I stand for... When last did you stand for Jesus? Only you. You have stood for 45 preachers. And Jesus is saying, why will you not stand for me like this? Why is it that your popular man of God is more, you respect your big preacher more than you respect Jesus? Why? An able minister has only one audience, and that is Jesus the Christ. Your success in ministry is that way you can represent Jesus Christ to your generation. It's not the car you park in your garage. It's not your gown. It's not how much you have. It's how much of Jesus your generation can see in your life. Able ministers may not be popular ministers, but they are consecrated ministers. They are pure ministers. They are effective ministers. They are seasoned, mature ministers. They might not be popular, but they are effective. They are thorough. When you give them opportunity to come and preach and teach, they won't come and say, what are we now going to say now? No, they are prepared before the Lord. You don't take ministry casually. Ministry is not, please help me. Ministry is not freestyle. You the souls and the destiny of men are your hands. If I disrespect this of human, you go out and say rubbish. On the mountain of transfiguration, Peter, James, and John, they saw Jesus, right? And Jesus was transfigured before them. And Moses was there. Elijah was there. And the Bible said that after a while, a thief came out of place, and Moses said this, and Elijah left this, and the voice spoke from heaven. God spoke from heaven, saying about Jesus, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to me. And Peter was about to say, Master, let us be prepared. Moses apostolic ministry, Elijah fire ministry, and Jesus eternal salvation ministry. So Timothy showed, Timothy is over what? Imagine if the voice did not speak from heaven saying, Jesus is one of the city.
Peter, who was to be the head of the church, gave that example.
And be saying, you can see the following Moses, so
Moses, and we saw Moses, so Peter will class Moses and Elijah in the class of Jesus. And he has defeated the work of God. He has destroyed the work of God.
So Jesus had to recorrect the theology of Peter. So Elijah left, Moses left, then Jesus was revealed. It was that same Jesus that Peter spoke about, and 3,000 souls were saved. It was that same Jesus that Peter, it was one of the historians that said, when persecution hit Jerusalem, and everybody was running away, Peter too was trying to run away from the gate of Jerusalem, because Peter stood in Jerusalem. And as Peter was running outside of Jerusalem, he saw Jesus coming into Jerusalem. Jesus asked, Peter, where are you going? Peter now repented and went back to Jerusalem, where there was Matthias and the saved of Jesus.
An able minister is also ready to lay down his life for his master. This one might not be a popular point, but we need to prepare you as leaders, as Christian ministers, for this martyrdom. All the apostles of Jesus died for him, except John the Beloved. But John the Beloved also suffered many things. Are you ready to die for Jesus? You don't want them to beat your Brazilian hair. You are the one that will die for Jesus. Your makeup, that your toenail that you just paint, you don't want anything to scratch it. That is, we need to wake up. A Muslim can blow himself to kingdom come because of Muhammad, but tell a Christian to come and stay up all night at 4 o'clock of Egypt. After, by 12 o'clock, he's dozing off already. And these are the kingdom soldiers,
kingdom warriors. No, you can't, our soldiers of Christ, all day long, come and also came. Tell them to come for night duty. By 1 o'clock, there's dozing off. Are those the ones that want to take nations? Wake up. Wake up. Turn to your neighbor and say, wake up.
this is a rotten shit. That moment when Bishop David Oyedepo comes to you and comes and says, wake up. Glory to God. Able ministers don't go late for ministration. If you have been called to go and minister somewhere, by 9 o'clock, you get by 9 o'clock.
When my brother entered and said that the people who are going to find his back, we have to be intentional about those things. Even when me myself, when I was coming, the people who are going to
carry my bike, I said, let me carry my load by myself. The way I brought it from Ibadan. We are not just teaching you by doctrine. Our lifestyle is also a message to you. Because from how many select people are here? How many other denominations are here?
Baptist, Catholic, Anglican, Foursquare, Winners, MFN.
You are the next leaders of the church. We don't just disciple people by what we say. Our lifestyle too is a message. You are not just an able minister by what you are preaching. Your life, if somebody has to tell you that and you call yourself a Christian,
if you have to ever hear that thing, somebody said, and you call yourself a Christian, you should go back to your home and cry and say, Lord, have mercy on me.
Your lifestyle should preach Jesus. You should be a living epistle of God, of the kingdom of God. Not of the letters, but of the spirit. Can we rise up to pray? God wants to make some people here his able ministers, his weapons of war, so that he can secure a victory in this generation. Not of the letters, but of the spirit. For the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. And if you want to pray, Olubala, Emi mi mo ni mo fe, Jesus, reveal yourself to me. That is the prayer point. I can't be an able minister if I don't know my sender. How can you represent somebody you don't know? If you don't know the life in Christ Jesus, how can you represent the Christ? Jesus, reveal yourself to me today. I know that I have known you. I have known some things about you. Prophet and pastors and teachers, they have spoken to me about you. But I don't just want to hear about you. I want to see you today. Kabibara soselian parakatela. Ferregeten drenikus kapadiata. Elerugian dali gendreketes doston prokotila. Shalabababababarakataliete. Don't wait for the music. Pray. I ask for an encounter today. I ask for a revelation of who you are. Praise God. An encounter with the Christ. New marching orders. New marching orders. Roska Tante Presketelia Tosa. Lera Bashandalia Tosa. Rakate Porukatalia. Aisoselia Paruketeli. Relepo. Shiakataliata. Bara le conde lise celia. Zolika Rabakata. Rakata Bragata Papa Rukatali Reba Sate Koska Dambra Naso Soliata. We ask for transformation. We want to transform. Thank you.
Now, there are some people here that need clarity about your purpose in life. You are doing something now, and it's not wrong. What the apostle said, this man tonight, there was a precision, there was a clarity, there was an accuracy about what Jesus instructed the apostle. Even Jesus said, "One cannot do anything except that he sees the Father." He wants me to see that if you need that clarity from heaven, the gate of silence. Spirit, the teaching unction. And so, Father, I stretch forth my hands. I sit upon my throne in Christ Jesus. I stand before the fire and before the glory. And I pray, Heavenly Father, for as many that desire this gift, this anointing, this unction to teach the word of God, so that in their ministries they will be effective. Father, I pray that right now from my left hand to my right hand, let that unction come upon your people. Come upon your people. Come upon your people. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. All right. So let's wait. Let's wait. Father, we thank you. Now, I'm going to count to 7. And after 7, I'm going to stop counting. And I'll drop the microphone and I'll take my seat. So, Father, those people that you want to give the gift of teaching, the ability to teach the scriptures, And maybe some of them are also being called into the office of a teacher. Because this is a minister's conference, things must be given to God's people. Father, at the count of seven as instructed, baptize these ones without unction. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we bless your name. Thank you for that which you have done amongst us this morning. From the first session to this second session. Thank you because line upon line, precept upon precept, you are imparting us, you are teaching us, you are building us, you are equipping us for greater grace, for greater glory, for greater works. We seal up tonight's convocation with the blood of Jesus. We decree and declare that through the preaching and the teaching of the word of God and much prayers and shared burdens, that men and women, your sons and daughters on this campus, will come into the reality and the fullness of their ordinations in Christ Jesus. We ask that thy kingdom come, O God, thy will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. And the people of God say,
but Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. I am sure you have been blessed by the word of God from his messenger today. You can get more apostolic and prophetic teachings on Facebook at facebook.com/JT Olakunle, Telegram at t.me/JT Olakunle, and YouTube at Jonathan Titilola Olakunle. Feel free to contact the ministry via any of the social media platforms or WhatsApp at +234 810 970 1955, +234 810 970 1955. Jesus loves you.